Welcome to Real Chemistry. Today we're going to talk about acids reacting with bases. And an acid, recall, is anything that gives up hydrogen ions into solution when it's put into water, just like this hydrochloric acid does down below. And a base is anything that gives off hydroxide ions into water when it's dissolved, just like this sodium hydroxide down here. And it turns out something pretty special happens when you mix hydroxide with those hydrogen ions. And we're going to talk about what that is. Our main goal is to predict the products that will form when we combine an acid and a base. So let's go ahead and start with this reaction right here. What happens when you combine hydrochloric acid and sodium hydroxide? First, we're going to walk through it sort of conceptually, and then I'm going to give you a list of steps to follow that will always give you the right products. So remember that when I put HCl into solution, it splits up into hydrogen ions and chlorine ions. And when I put sodium hydroxide into solution, it splits up into sodium ions and hydroxide ions. And it turns out that what happens is the hydroxide ions combine with the hydrogen ions. And when they do that, you get one oxygen and two hydrogens, and that turns out to be water. Now, water is not an ionic compound, so you have these two ions combining to make water, which is a molecular compound. So whenever you combine an acid or base, one of your products is water. The other product you get is a ionic compound. In this case, we see that we're left with chlorine and sodium. Sodium's positive and chlorine's negative. And so they hang out together and form an ionic compound. So when I mix HCl and sodium hydroxide, I get out water and sodium chloride. And you always get a water and an ionic compound when you mix together an acid and a base. Let's take a look at a few examples that might differ from this just a little bit, but follow the same general pattern. So now we're going to combine nitric acid, HNO3, with potassium hydroxide. Now, notice in this case we have nitric acid, which has a polyatomic ion, NO3, and we just treat that like one ion, like we always do. So the very first step is that you combine the hydrogen ions in your hydroxides to make water. So we always get out water. And that gets rid of our hydroxides. That's where hydroxides went into that water. It also gets rid of our hydrogen. And so step two says the remaining ions form an ionic compound. What ions remain? Well, potassium remains, and so does nitrate. And so we just get out potassium nitrate. Now, the third step says balance the charges. What does that mean? Well, when you form your ionic compound, you need to make sure that it's neutral, because ionic compounds should always be written as neutral compounds. And if I take a look, potassium, we know, has a +1 charge, and nitrate has a -1 charge. So those are actually already neutral. We have one potassium at +1 and one nitrate at -1, giving us a neutral compound. So the charges are already balanced. We can just write our ionic compound as KNO3, and that's a neutral one. The next step is balance the reaction. Well, if you take a careful look, this reaction is actually already balanced. But in the next few problems, we'll see some reactions that aren't balanced. And I'm actually going to leave that step for you to do. If you need some help balancing the chemical reactions, check out my video, Balancing Chemical Reactions. Once you get the unbalanced reactions, you just follow the steps in that video to finish the problem. Okay, so that's done, and it turns out to be balanced. Let's take a look at another acid-base reaction. This time, we're combining phosphoric acid with sodium hydroxide. When we do that, we once again, just as always, combine our hydroxides and our protons, that is our hydrogen ions, to make water. So we get out water, and we also are going to get out an ionic compound. So what ions are left? Well, we have sodium and we have phosphate. And sodium and phosphate are going to combine to form an ionic compound. So now we've done steps one and two. So what we need to take a look at now is balancing the charges in our ionic compound. So what I do is I just go ahead and write out both the ions I have, and we know that sodium is +1, and phosphate is 3-. Now that's something that you should have memorized. If you don't have it memorized though, you can figure it out from how many hydrogens were paired with phosphate. Since there were 3 hydrogens paired with phosphate originally, that tells you that phosphate must be a -3 to make phosphoric acid neutral. Okay, so you know that phosphate's 3-, and sodium's 1+. How do you make that neutral? Well, you can just sort of think about it and realize, hey, I need 3 sodiums to balance out that charge. You can also do what's called crossing over, which is where I take this charge down here to tell me the number of sodiums I have, and this charge up here to tell me how many phosphates I have. And so what that's going to give me then is 3 sodiums for every one phosphate. And that's a balanced charge. If you're not sure how to write those balanced charges, check out my naming ionic compounds video, and I go through in more detail how you balance those charges. So that means that we should have three sodiums with our phosphate. So now we're done except for balancing the chemical reaction. And like I said, I'll leave balancing the chemical reaction to you. If you need help doing that, go ahead and watch my balancing chemical reactions video. All right, another reaction we could imagine is combining hydrobromic acid, that's HBr, with calcium hydroxide. What happens there? Well, same thing. We combine our hydroxides and our hydrogen ions to make water. So we get rid of this guy, and we get rid of this guy, and that makes water. And then we investigate, what ions do we have left over? So that's step two. What ions do we have left over? Well, we have calcium left over, and we have bromine left over. So that's going to form our ionic compound. Remember, you always need to write the positive ion first. We always write the cation first, or another way to put it is we always write the metal first. So I'm going to write CaBr. That always applies when you write ionic compounds. You should write the positive thing before the negative thing. And now what we're going to do, step three, we're going to make sure the charges of our ionic compound are balanced. So we have Ca and we have Br, and we can predict the charges on those. If you're not sure how to do that, check out my video predicting the charges on ions. And you can basically do this using the periodic table. So now we have calcium at 2 plus and bromine at 1 minus. That tells me I need two bromines to balance out my calcium. That'll give me two things at negative 1 for a total negative charge of negative 2. And that'll balance out my total positive charge of plus 2. Again, if you want to, you can also think about it as crossing over. And that's going to give me calcium Br2. And so there should be a 2 on our bromine, so that we have a neutral ionic compound. So that is a completed acid-base reaction. There's some balancing work to be done before you could be said to have finished the problem. Again, check out that balancing reactions video if you need help with that. All right, so that is acid-base reactions. When you combine an acid and a base, you always get out water and an ionic compound. The main challenge is making sure that ionic compound is balanced in terms of its charges, and then balancing the chemical reaction. If you have any questions, please leave them below. Please subscribe to get updates about future videos, or visit my channel to see other chemistry videos.